بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر وأنت على كل شيء قدير. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، واجعل التفرق بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تدع فينا شقيا ولا محروما. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most compassionate, the most merciful, all praise and thanks are due to him, and peace and blessings be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He who is guided by the will of Allah, no one can misguide him, and he who is misguided, no one can guide him except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. We are still in the battle of Uhud. Sorry for this. Okay. We are still in the battle of Uhud, and we have a lot of details still. Just quick reminder. Seerah, one of the main goals that we aim from studying the Seerah is to gain the guidance, the general guidance in our existence and life. Seerah is much more wider than the context of Sunnah. I keep repeating, just to fix it in your mind. When we speak about Sunnah or Hadith, we are talking about the direct rulings and teachings of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with what is related to do and don't, haram, halal, legal, illegal, permissible, not permissible. Which is directly has to do with what Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, did, acted upon, they acted upon. We call it the Sunnah. Seerah, in this sense, it's much wider. It covers the events, the emotions, the relations, the social interactions, the surroundings, the context, okay, the history. So it's more or less, my word, as if when you study the Seerah, you understand the Sunnah within the movie film. Okay? As if you have a wider vision. Oh, so this is, okay? In Sunnah, you know, Prophet Muhammad, for example. Now, I will give you just a simple example. Now, we will read Hadith Sahih, how Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not pray the prayer, the normal janazah prayer on the Shahada of Uhud. He did not. He just asked them to be collected. Now there is a fiqh hukum now. There's a rulings. Okay? Like a shaheed, la yughassal, wa la yukaffan, wa la yusalla alayh. Which means, they have a specific. Now, when you know it as a hukum, as a ruling, as a teaching, for example, it's much different from, you know, how it started, what was the context, the emotional, okay, the spiritual, the social. This was applicable on who, how did it happen? Your understanding for the hukum, it will be 10 times more powerful, more fixed, and it will, bi'ibnillah, inshallah, strengthen you with the power of making the analogy and applying it on your daily life than having it just as a teaching or a ruling. Simple example. Now today, we have a title called Al-Jam'u Bayna Al-Shuhada'i Fi Al-Qabr Al-Wahid. To gather more than one shaheed, one martyr in one grave. This is a special ruling. Now for us, it's a matter, it's a fiqh issue, okay? It's related to someone who was killed defending the deen and defending the honor and defending the ummah. Can we put in one grave more than one? It happened. Look what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and look to the context now of what happened in the battle of Uhud. Jabir radiallahu anhu, Jabir bin Abdullah, he's narrating in a sahih hadith. قال أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يجمع بين الرجلين من قتل أحد في ثوب واحد ثم يقول أيهم أكثر أخذا للقرآن
فإذا أشير له إلى أحدهما قدمه في اللحد وقال أنا شهيد على هؤلاء وأمر بدفنهم بدمائهم ولم يصلي عليهم ولم يغسلهم.
So, we will understand why. The hadith basically, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when you know, because they lost 70. And just for your information, is anyone in here who knows what's the percentage of the Ansar and what's the percentage of the Muhajirin from the 70? Do you have an idea? 64 to 6. To whom? 64 Ansar and 6 Muhajirin. Do you know what does this mean? Look how difficult the test was for the Ansar. You know why I'm telling you that? Go back in the history now to Badr. You remember? Just to connect things together. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to see how Muslims will be tested. So it's to try to relate to what happens to Gaza and Palestine now, which is simple test in the history of Muslims, by the way. It's not the end of the time. We have a lot of tests. We are all tested and we will be tested. We are now tested and we still will be tested. Now, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you remember, when they left and they were behind the caravan, simply they wanted to return back some of their money which was taken from them when they were kicked out from Mecca, in a simple way. If you remember, out of a sudden, the caravan changed the route because Abu Sufyan knew that they are coming. Next point, meanwhile, Abu Jahl already has decided, and Ahl Mecca, the people of Mecca, already has left Mecca with an army of 1,000. Now, after Abu Sufyan managed to escape with the caravan, he sent to the army, "Khalas, go back." Finished. Now, meanwhile, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the revelation, "وَدِيَعِدُكُمُ اللَّهُ إِحْدَى الطَّائِفَتَيْنِ أَنَّهَا لَكُمْ." Now, they were given the option. You Muslims, they were behind the caravan is saved. Now the army is coming. You have the option to withdraw, by the way, just to leave everything as is. By the will of Allah, we know that, you know, Abu Jahl insisted to go there. And you remember how many lessons we took from this. He insisted. Subhanallah, Allah wanted to finish him there. In the same thing now, it was an embarrassment. I'm speaking politically now. Politically. It was very embarrassing situation to who? You know to who? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because he has, go back, the agreement, Medina Covenant, Abayat al-Aqaba, we came back. The agreement originally was, from the very beginning, that the Ansar will host the Muhajirin and defend them as they defend their families from any danger that attacks them in Medina. This was the condition. This is a new situation now. It's very embarrassing. Because, okay, before, wait, there is a deal, there is an agreement, there is a covenant, Ahd Mithaq. Prophet Muhammad has no ethical right now, depending on the agreement, to blame or to ask or to push any Ansari to carry on and to have any type of battles against the Mushrikeen. Because according to the agreement, they are out of, you know, completely the agreement. They have the full right and they will not be committing haram thing. If they said, we have not agreed about this. If the Ansar withdrew and they went to the Medina, they are not committing anything haram, by the way. They are just fulfilling the agreement. If you remember, a very beautiful, amazing reaction from Ansar happened when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gathered them before taking the final decision when he said, "Ashiru alayya ayyuhal qawm. Tell me, what do you think? Shall we proceed? Shall we go and fight or return? But what do you think?" He's doing shura. Okay? For those people to speak about democracy, we have the shura 1400 years ago when they were, you know, killing each other. I don't know who, but they were killing each other. If you consider this part of democracy, which has to do with the discussion and the voting, we have it 1400 years ago. Anyway, so Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was sitting with Ansar al-Muhajirin. أشيروا عليها القام. Tell me, what do you think? One of the Muhajirin, like Abu Bakr spoke, رضي الله عنه. أشيروا, I asked the same question. Another one happened, we say coincidentally, was the will of Allah, from the Muhajirin spoke. Then he kept. Then one of the leaders of the Ansar قال, وَكَأَنَّكَ تُرِيدُنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ They noticed, he's insisting till one of the leaders of the Ansar speaks. He's not pushing. He's just keeping opening. Then, I forgot, Sa'd ibn Ma'ad, I think. Or Sa'd ibn Ma'ad, yes. فسعد معاذ رضي الله عنه when he stood up قال يا رسول الله وكأنك تريدنا as if you want us Ansar now قال يا رسول الله لن نقول لك كما قالت بنو إسرائيل لموسى we will our status and reaction and attitude will not by any way be like what the children of Israel did with Musa عليه السلام when they said اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا إنها هنا قاعدون look اذهب أنت وربك فقاتل go you and your Lord and fight we are sitting in our places ولكن لا نقول لك إلا اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا إنا معكما مقاتلون go our dear prophet with your Lord and we are fighting with you قال والله لو خط فينا هذا البحر لخضناه معك. If there is a sea now, they were in the desert. If there is a sea, which is very dangerous. They can't swim, they don't swim. And you ask us to go through the sea with you, we will go through it. Which means, whatever, you just ask us. Then Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم felt released. Because he doesn't want to break the promise. Or to break the deal. This was one of the greatest reactions of the Ansar. Let's come now to the second, which is indirectly. The Battle of Uhud. People of Mecca came to take revenge, basically, from their people. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and his group. Who paid the highest cost? Ansar. 64 out of 70. What's the percentage? More or less, I think, 88%. Nearly 90%. Nearly. How much? 91%. 90%! In the political calculations, okay, they are not supposed to have this kind of big harm. Because they are secondary element in the whole equation. But don't judge them now. Look at that, because still in the phases of establishing the state of Islam. Okay? Still, you know, step by step. So, this to give you an idea how great the Ansar were. Plus, I want you to connect this with another incident still. Maybe we'll reach it months coming when we come to Fatih Makkah. When the conqueror of Makkah at the eighth year. Still we are in year three now. Sorry, in year five. Now, we have 3 years. A lot of incidents. A lot of things happened. Astaghfirullah azim and asif. In year three still. We are in a battle of, I forget there. My mind went to Hunayn and Al-Khandaq. Still, because I was reading Al-Khandaq today. Now we are in Uhud. Badr second year, Uhud third year, Fatih Mecca, the conqueror of Mecca at the eighth year. And why I'm connecting now, I'm just highlighting the value of the Ansar. And how, just to tell you, the fact that they came late does not mean they were not first. This is for us as individual. But what does this mean? Yeah. Because what happened, when Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the conqueror of Mecca, they were afraid that Prophet Muhammad, after he conquered Marta, he returned back to his home. Back home, Qalas. Back home. And Prophet Muhammad Sallam was narrated about him that he loves Mecca. It's the hometown. He was born there. Everything is there. You know, any one of us, the hometown of you is really very dear to your heart because all of your memories, your existence is there. Subhanallah.
The Ansar, they were skeptical. You know, speaking between themselves, do you think he will stay in Mecca and leave us خلاص, after everything is finished? Prophet Muhammad noticed. And he decided to return back. And he started to make dua to Al-Ansar. And there is another incident at Hunayn. When he started distributing the spoils, he did not give the Ansar. He gave those new Muslims. So what happened? Muhammad changed his mind. But he said something. All of them started crying. Radiallahu anhu. You know, because they thought that he started favoring others. خلاص, يعني, they've done the job and everything is finished. You know, human beings. قال ألا ترضون أن يذهب الناس بالغنائم وترجعون برسول الله. Don't you accept that the people will go with the spoils and you return back with Rasulullah with you? You are shocked. It means you are the best. And I personally with you. Allahumma rahma al-ansar. Allahumma ghafir lil-ansar. You know? So you need to know this. By the way, just another usul fiqh issue, hadith issue, fiqh issue. Now just to learn it from the context. What did Mu'adh in the second year of Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, when he was about to give his opinion on behalf of the Ansar, what he quoted? He said, إِنَّ لَن نَقُولَ لَكَ كَمَا قَالَ بَنُوا إِسْرَائِيلَ لِمُوسَى اِذْهَبْ أَنْتَ وَرَبُّكَ فَقَاتِلَا. You understand by default that definitely before the second year, this part of chapter al-Baqarah was revealed. So you understand from fiqh point of view, if you want to do to the abrogation, nasikh or mansukh, or mutaqaddim or ta'akhir, or am or khas, this kind of, this, in what we call the science of the principles of Islamic jurisprudence, ilm usul al-fiqh, to see which ayah came first, because you know, in Islam, tartib al-nuzul is different from tartib al-surah in the Quran. The order of the revelation differs from the order of the final version of the Quran, which is part of the ijaz. Sometimes some ayat from a chapter comes from, for example, from 26 to 72. 2 years later, Jibreel alayhi salam might come and he reveals 10 ayat and you ask Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this 10 ayat comes from 16 to 26. After that, what? And by the way, with the people, some honest, just genuine researchers, this in itself made him say, this is impossible. Who can do this? This is part of the ijaz. Anyway, but I'm just giving you an idea sometimes how studying the seerah will put you in the context sometimes to realize that before the second year, this ayah, now if we knew from another hadith sahih that most of chapter al-Baqarah, for example, was revealed altogether, we understand that what we are discussing, that many of the ahkam in chapter al-Baqarah revealed before, for example, the Battle of Uhud. So what does this mean? You will benefit later when you study things, what come after, what come, why, when, how, why, for example. I'm giving you a philosophical example, not a real one now. Imagine that, this is very theoretical, it's not real, because just in my mind. Imagine that in the battle of, imagine that inside Surah Al-Baqarah, there is one of the verses about the hijab. So up to the third year, they were not revealed. Imagine that we had something, for example, that one of the Sahabiyat, they were with them in the Battle of Uhud. Sorry, Battle of Badr. Okay? And something revealed, time of Uhud, you knew from the context. And in the context was mentioned that he saw some, and he recognized her. And you understand from the context, she was not wearing the hijab. If someone came and say, but how come she's not wearing the hijab? Simply because the ayah, they were not revealed. How did you know? Because this happened in Badr, and the ayah was revealed, for example, after Fatah Makkah, or revealed after Hunayn, or revealed after Al-Khandaq. So knowing the history from the seerah will give you sometimes a power
how to know, طب why this happened, if you know it just like this, طب when, you might be confused. Well, this is very simple for one who understands the history of, you know, the thing. Just information. طيب. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, according to Jabir رضي الله عنه, he used to gather two men in one grave, and he was asking, who أيهم أكثر أخذا القرآن, which one of them was close and taking, reading, doing تكبر more for the Quran. They say, for example, this man, he used to put him first as a sign of honor. طبعا قال قدمه في اللحد, قال وأنا شهيد على هؤلاء, and I will be a witness for those that they were killed in the sake of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. وأمر بدفنهم, and he commanded to put them in their graves with their blood. ولا, he did not pray the janazah on them, and he did not do any kind of ghusl using the water as we normally, basically, because part of the Islamic rituals, when someone passes away, we have ghusl janazah, we cleanse the body, we clean the body with the water with a special manner. Then we do special, we bring a special piece of white clothes and we cover it. We call it the kafan or the coffin. Okay, then we do the janazah. These three, they are not applicable. With their own clothes, they just, we cover them and they put their as is with their blood. But why? Look to what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, Jabir, in another riwayah, he says, in the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said about those who were killed in Uhud, لا تغسلوهم فإن كل جرح أو كل دم يفوح مسكا يوم القيامة ولم يصلي عليهم. One of the justifications, he said, this injured, this bleeding of the blood will come with them in the day of judgment and it will give you the smell of the musk. طب how? We don't know. طب يا عمي, the body is ruined now, there will be some, it's not my business or your business. I mean, the idea that when someone is killed as a martyr in specific in the battlefield, he has a special status in Islam. This special status will witness for him that he did one of the highest ranked, let's say, things in Islam, which means he sold himself to protect his people, his deen, his honor, his woman, his, you know, he was fighting to defend the oppressed people, one of the high, because now selling yourself, which means you are killed to protect the oppressed people, is one of the highest honored thing. This is like a Islamic teachings, but we do not deal with it in a mathematical way. The proof to me scientifically that this blood will stay as is and the smell will stay as is. I mean, forget it. We don't deal with it because Aslan, the body will be ruined completely, yes. And we will be resurrected again. We will be created with a new body, by the way. Not the same body. Complete it with ruined, yes. In a few days or weeks, depends on the piece of land you are buried in, you might disappear or might stay or whatever, but it completely خلاص, finished. But this is what Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, it's a matter of faith. And in another narration, قال أنا شهيد على هؤلاء إنه ما من جريح يجرح في سبيل الله إلا والله يبعثه يوم القيامة يدمى جرحه اللون لون دم والريح ريح مسك. In another narration, he said, I'm a witness and I bear witness I'm giving you. None who will be killed for the sake of Allah, protecting his honor, his deen, his people, his existence, his, I don't know, many reasons to protect, fighting for the sake of defending, especially the oppressed people, but he will be resurrected in the day of judgment and the blood will be bleeding. It will be like a sign, like a flag, that this one is a martyr. Rest of the people, and by the way, you know, part of our aqidah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy everything in the universe. Complete destruction, everything. And Allah will recreate, according to Sahih al-Bukhari, a new piece of land. قال بيضاء نقية لم يرتكب عليها إثم. A new piece of land, completely clean, no sin has been committed on it. And people will be resurrected and congregated on this piece of land. And you can imagine how billions we will be. Now, we are 7 billions. During the history of humanity, Just try to imagine how many millions they used to be and how many billions still will be. And maybe the Qiyamah still maybe 200, 300, 400 years or less. By the way, be careful. Some people, they say Qiyamah. No, wait, still. The Mahdi will come. Isa alayhi salam will come. Ad-Dajjal will come. And still, a lot of things still. But can you imagine with a quick mathematical calculation, the 7 billion, 200 years, for example, it could be, anyway, billions. Yeah. All of them, they will be gathered and we will be completely naked. And this is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, and Aisha heard Prophet Muhammad وسلم saying, قال يحشر الناس يوم القيامة حفاتا عراتا غرلا. One of the things that will be reserved, I'm just mentioning that to mention the shaheed now, okay? قال يحشر الناس يوم القيامة, they will be completely naked and barefoot. Aisha, you know, Aisha was shocked. يا رسول الله أو ينظر بعضهم إلى بعض. قالت يا رسول الله, they will be looking at each other. قالت يا عائشة, الأمر أعظم من ذلك. قالت يا عائشة, it's much much more scary and horrible, more that no one will think about whether this one is naked, the other one males or females. No, خلاص, جهنم is waiting now. جهنم is waiting. خلاص, it's the reality now. We are resurrected after نعيم عذاب القبر. It's beyond your expectation, the horrible. Anyway, we come back. At that, قال يبعث يوم القيامة يسيل منه الدم والرائحة المسك. Let's imagine the situation now. One of the signs that will honor those martyrs, another pose. We are not talking about the martyrs who followed Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Any martyr who was following the Prophet of his time, and he was defending his deen, his people, his land, his honor. He was killed for the sake of Allah, following one of the 124,000 prophets. He's a martyr, which could be millions, but millions out of billions. How they will be honored? How they will be? One of the signs they will realize them: the blood will be fresh. And the smell, which is a sign, by the way, a sign of honor. Like, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْعَالَى وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْعَالَى. It's like when you go to a big conference or big event and you have a VIP card. Sometimes they give you the badge. Once you came to the entrance, they say, hello sir, please, this is a red badge. The rest, they have for that a golden badge, black badge, white badge, yellow badge, whatever. The red one is the VIP. Anyone sees the red badge, just immediately special treatment. We do this. So, subhanAllah, the blood, the red blood will be like a sign. The blood is coming, that is shaheed. He's honored. You know, I wish if I was him or I were in his place. This is part of Uhud. Now, the other one that I will finish with it, inshallah, bidnillah, because as I told you, my aim is just to add a some piece of information and connect it with many things in our lives. Bismillah. Jazakumullah khairan for the coffee. Barakallahu feekum. Thank you very much. Allah ikramkum ya Rabbi urhamu walidaykum. Now, Masruq radiyallahu anhu, Masruq is one of the Sahaba, says, Sa'al Asif. Masruq is one of the Tabi'een. One of the Tabi'een says, Sa'alna Abdullahi an hadhihi al-aya. Abdullahi means Abdullah ibn Abbas. One of the Tabi'een asks one of the Sahaba, which is Abdullah ibn Abbas. We asked him, you know, Ibn Abbas, his title was Turjuman al-Qur'an. One of his titles, the translator of the Qur'an. One of the greatest Sahaba of understanding the Qur'an. He says, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. Don't think those who were killed for the sake of Allah that they are dead. Actually, they are alive and they are receiving rizq, sustenance. Now, what? Now, it's a matter of ghaib now. It's unseen. It has nothing to do with science. It has nothing to do with history. It has to do with ikhbar bil ghaib. Literally, it's either you believe or you don't believe, which is part of al-iman bil ghaib. Look, what? This Allah says in the Quran, We might not be able to know the exact how, because we don't know the how, by the way, generally. But look what Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم explained about this ayah.
Ibn Abbas says, قال أما إنا قد سألنا عن ذلك.
When one of the tabi'een, the followers of the Sahaba, asked Ibn Abbas, what does it mean? He said, just for your information, we asked the same question. I know you are curious to ask me about it. We were, and we asked about it, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Then he continued, فقال, which means Prophet Muhammad told us, صلى الله عليه وسلم, أرواحهم في جوف طير خضر لها قناديل معلقة بالعرش تسرح من الجنة حيث شاءت ثم تأوي إلى تلك القناديل.
Believe it or not, we don't know the how now. Literally, this is hadith صحيح. قال, their spirits, by the way, we are not talking about the final destination of the Jannah. It's part of their نعيم القبر. نيالك عاسمك انت ما شاء الله. كل شوي نعيم القبر نعيم القبر. ما شاء الله. You see? Now pause. We believe as Muslims in what we call al-barzakh. It's part of our faith. Al-barzakh literally means the barrier. Barrier between two things. In our aqidah, in our faith, we believe in three main phases of our existence, or actually four. Our spirits are created before we are born. Number one, we know nothing about it. But we were told that our souls already created. وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ وَظُهُورَهُمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Long time ago. Time. What we know now, stage number two, or if you wish one for us, from the moment where this, your soul has been injected in the womb of your mother, you started being in this dunya, which according to the khilaf, 42 days or 120 days of pregnancy. That's why abortion is haram, and it could be literally a murder in Islam. Murder. You're killing human beings. Anyway, طيب, we start. It ends by death. Then death is a gate to stage number two, which is the barzakh. Barzakh ends by the beginning of the hereafter, starting the day of judgment. We believe at the very beginning with the resurrection and congregation, al-ba'thu wa nushur, accountability, this day will be 50,000 years. What? Allah said it in the Quran. في يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة. 50,000 years accountability. Then Jannah or Nar. Okay? Now stage al-barzakh, which is the barrier. It contains two main possibilities for the souls. No third option. It's either adab al-qabr or na'im al-qabr. The pleasure of the qabr or the punishment of the qabr, of the grave. Which is just the first step, mild, not the top. What's the evidence? And when Allah was speaking about Pharaoh and his followers, النَّارُ يُعْرَضُونَ عَلَيْهَا غُدُوًا وَعَشِيًّا وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةَ أَدْخِلُوا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ أَشَدَّ الْعَذَابِ. The people of Pharaoh, which could be, now historically, Fir'aun Musa, not all the Fir'aun, 3,500 years, more or less. Now, in our understanding, realization, since 3,500 years, Fir'aun and his soldiers, they are exposed. يعرضون. Okay? We don't know how. Screen, feelings, something. Some, Allahu A'lam the way. They are exposed to the hellfire twice a day. And in the day of judgment will come, they will be thrown into the أشد العذاب, the highest level, severe of punishment. This is one of the biggest evidences about the existence of عذاب القبر. Okay? What about نعيم القبر, the pleasure of the قبر? We have ayat and we have hadith. The ayah, إن الذين قالوا ربنا الله ثم استقاموا تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون. Those who believe in Allah and they declare their identity as Muslims and we feel proud of it and they were on the straight path, when they are approaching death, circle angels will come to them, welcoming them to the Akhirah. This is part of the honor. And in another hadith sahih, a lot of details about that. قال إن الرجل كان في انقطاع من الدنيا وإقبال على الآخر يأتيه رجل صبيح الوجه فيقول من أنت يا ذا الوجه الصبيح صبحك الله أنا عملك الصالح. With a lot of hadith about how he will be welcomed, then he will go to sleep like a nap, then he will open to the day of judgment, and a lot of details in hadith sahih in the Quran. But the idea, now this is part of what? Al-ghayb. That we don't know the how. Because some people keep, because of the influence of materialistic way of understanding, the secular, the non-faith-based mentality, they keep looking from mathematical way, prove it in the lab. No one can prove it in the lab. This is beyond. This is part of the ghaib. Actually, even your physical life, existence, physical life, many things you can prove it scientifically. Explain to me scientifically dreams. How you are dreaming and in your dream, who creates the dream? How the dream makes you think really, and sometimes you open your eyes, you feel the taste of the food in the dream, and sometimes you feel still the heart beating because the lion which was about to eat you, it was just, boom, 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 boom. How? Where is it? The imagination. Who created the imagination? Who controls the imagination? Who creates the idea? Who gives the influence? Who gives the authority? No. No scientific answer. No. They do ijtihadat sometimes. We think, some kind of psychiatry or something. But it's a phenomena that scientifically you can't know exactly how to dream. Time. About the timing. Sometimes you take a nap for 15 minutes. In your dream, you thought it's 2 years or 10 hours. When you open, you say, I've been for the last 6 months, a big lion's about to eat me. You just took a nap for 5 minutes. Explain it to me scientifically. No explanation. No explanation. So this is part of our life. So when someone can say, how can I know this is true? Salli al-Nabi. اللهم صل على سيد محمد. Look, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When we ask Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about this martyrs, according to this ayah, ولا تحسبن الذين قتلوا بل أحياء. They are killed. Don't think they are dead. They are still what? Alive. قال عند ربي يرزقون, and they are receiving the rizq, the sustenance from their Lord. What? Look what Allah subhanahu wa taala said. قال أما أن قد سألنا أرواحهم, their souls will be inside طير خضر, green birds. We don't know which type of birds. طيب, قال لها قناديل معلقة بالعرش, the throne of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We don't know what is it, we don't know how it's part of his great creation. قال قناديل, you know the قناديل, how to translate in English قناديل. Huh? I think chandeliers. Yes. Allah alam. Chandeliers. Something, something is connected and hanged like this so that the bird can stood in. Okay, like special hanging, let's say pieces, in a very nice way. The bird flies and goes and just settle on this candle. Anyway. The idea. قال لها قناديل معلقة بالعرش. They have special places where they settle next to the throne of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. قال تسرح من الجنة حيث شاءت ثم تأوي إلى تلك القناديل. They keep flying inside the Jannah. The nowadays Jannah. The Jannah that they will go and reside in it in the future with their new bodies. Now they are witnessing it through the shape of a bird. And their spirit is inside this bird. Don't ask me about the how now. We don't know the how. Because if someone insists to know the how, tell me how we save our information inside this flash. If you
told a child now that inside this there is a movie where people and elephant is chasing something inside it. How come? How did you save it? It does not make sense for him. This is technology. Okay, what's technology? It's a computer engineering. What's computer? It's electricity. What's electricity? It's programming. What's programming? You put 01010. What's the 01? How the 01 transfer to have an elephant with the full image and I have written inside this. The elephant is 1 million sides. How did you put the elephant inside it? Tell me the how. By the way, this is a physical thing. It's not imagination. Hey, we are living it. Hey, we have it. Inside this, for example, if this is a USB, for example, 10 giga, it contains maybe 1,000 movie. Each movie of them contains 1,000 whatever. How did I put it inside? Who knows? So please, I'm just not telling you. I'm giving you just an idea how to argue with someone if he asks, how come there is spirit inside? No. Just believe in it. We don't know how. That's it. قال تسرح في الجنة من الجنة حيث شاءت ثم تأوي إلى تلك القناديل. It goes back. فاطلع إليهم ربهم اطلاعا. الله سبحانه وتعالى looked at them. فقال هل تشتهون شيئا؟ Do you wish anything for the martyrs in specific? Do you wish anything? قالوا أي شيء نشتهي ونحن نسرح من الجنة. Said our Lord. How come we will wish while we are in the Jannah? We have the best now. فقال لهم ثلاث مرات. He continued الله سبحانه وتعالى three times. فلما رأوا أنهم لن يتركوا مي أن يسألوا when they saw that Allah is insisting on them to tell what they wish beyond what they are in. قال when they say قال يا رب نريد أن ترد أرواحنا في أجسادنا حتى نقتل في سبيلك مرة أخرى. فلما رأى أن ليس لهم حاجة تركوا. They said يا الله we want just if you accept which is against the قدر of Allah. If you accept that our souls will be returned back to our bodies in the dunya and we will be killed for your sake again. من عظم ما يرى من الأجر. From the amazing reward that they are witnessing. And still they are not in the full. Because still their souls are kept inside a berg. In a way we don't know. Which means it's like more or less a way of realizing. A way of testing. But not the full. The full is in the day of judgment. You will have a new body. You will full conscious. You will be resurrected with a body. And you will go to accountability. And you will go through the phases of تطاير الصحف. Okay, ها أم اقرأوا كتابي إني ظننت أني ملاك الحسابي فهو في عيشة راضية في جنة عالية. And the intercession and the شفاعة and the people will be gathered سبعة يظلهم الله. We have a lot of details, but this is like a phase of honoring just so far. How we don't know. It's under the this is the exact meaning of ولا تحسبن الذين قتلوا في سبيل الله أموات بل أحياء عند ربهم يرزقون. This is the meaning. Don't think those who were killed as martyrs for the sake of Allah, they are dead. Actually, they are alive. Special life. قال حياة خاصة. It's not like ours with a special life. Because you know, we don't. Once your soul is created, you are eternal. You just move from a phase to phase. Phase number one, nobody, no physical body. Phase number two, you came to this dunya with soul and body. Then phase number three, your body will be left. You will go with your soul in the barzakh. Phase number four, you will come again to the akhirah with a new body. Then you will go eternally, either or. Jannah or not. Once Allah took a decision of you to exist, you are eternal. But when you think about it, it's really scary. That's why death for us is just a gate between two phases. That's it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ay yarhamana.
I wanted just to highlight the concept of shuhada and some kind of other lessons around, we say, in the shadow of the context. Now, this is our final session before Ramadan. For Ramadan, we have no sessions. However, if you are interested, if you are from the surrounding neighborhood of the masjid, every night between the Taraweeh, after fourth rak'ah, we have in English a small khatir, inshallah. Number one, every Saturday, four Saturdays, inshallah, after Taraweeh, we have a lecture. It will differ for different topics if you are interested. Jazakumullah khair. See you tomorrow in our final tafsir session. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.